Okay, greetings, shalom, salant, tena yistling. Now, first part of overstanding seven Sheba. This is going, or Stargate, Heaven's Gate. This is concerning Wetito, Rastafari Senbet, study number seven. And this being the second part, before we go on to the visuals, we're going to just do a quick little review now. It begins with faith. We need to find a true faith. That faith establishes a reference point that we could look forward to and thus judge divine behavior, divine conduct, which is the form in which the divinity, the divine will, shows himself to be so, through law, through governance. Now, which is also Sheba, an oath. Now, and so we need that reference point as a marker, as a cross. Now, continuing, we are begotten into this world. We are begotten into darkness, along with all the ignorance and darkness that this world teaches us. It's creating this pretend self that is untrue. Now, spirit of truth, once we initiate movement, we initiate something true. This inspiration, this reason, we have the spirit of truth moving over the face of the waters. Now, this reason, this movement is an end to itself. It's an objective movement. An orderly, lawful movement, a compliance with all that is lawful. Now, this also is seen as a point of origin, a prime mover, the initiate burst of that spirit, the motivation. Now, continuing, we have to make mention that the fact that we step out of the false self into the real self, this being a non-movement movement, there is no movement, but still there is movement, creates a tripartite check and balance. You know, we cannot trust ourselves, the false selves, and so we need to step into the pursuit of the true self, which is initiated by a light shining in darkness, you know, by a leap of faith, nonetheless a going forward, but objectively. So now continuing, we have a motion of into all directions, and so there's six possible ways of which this motion can manifest to or towards. And number six is exhaust. It is an exhaustion of spaces, of distances, or actually movement into spaces of equal distances from its true nature, from its origin. And now the exhaustion of all possible manifestations of motion energy from self results in Sheba, in fulfillment. Now observation of the patterns of movement in all things reveal divine character and personality, and the manner in which movement chooses to move or chooses to navigate itself is in fact the spirit personality making itself known. Now it is up to us to be able to return to that point of origin, that reference point, and judge accordingly whether that faith is lawful and well and governed in good and thus true. And so continuing, if we are able to connect the dots, then we have a Shabbat, we have a Sembet, we have a rest, a fulfillment, a completion. Seven is not necessarily a movement, but it is a fulfillment in itself, automatic, when we are able to behold the manifestation. And so continuing, 6 days work, six possible ways in which the spirit can move, at least within equal distance from the point of origin, and the seventh day is rest. So 6 days of labor, and the seventh, the Sheba, the Sebat, is a fulfillment, a manifestation of the work previously done. So now, this results in the state of unbegotten. This becomes a formation and a creation into the likeness and image of the true creator. So continuing, at this point, one humbles himself to the divine will, allowing the spirit of truth to dictate that which is true. And so in another, we could put it in another way, and it would be, we being the clay, allow ourselves to be shaped and formed and molded to the potter's desire. Now, motion within law is divine will. We as man are able to perceive certain laws, universal laws and principalities with our senses, and by thus we can get an idea or come face to face with the divine will. But the majority of lawful motion is unseen, and that that is in fact the divine will. Perfect, seven being perfection, and whatever kind of movement that we are not able to perceive, it is the divine will imposing its ultimate agenda, and forcing it upon it to its fulfillment, forcing its manifestation with no exterior influence or outside force affecting it, for it is perfect. And those things we cannot see does not mean that they are not lawful and that they are not possible. It is the divine will, and it's the way, we could even say it is the way in which the divine will maintains control of everything, and thus making come to pass that which it wills. Not, you know, no way possible being affected by any outside force, for it is complete within itself. And so that which is perfect cannot be altered or influenced or modified. So now continuing, this results into, well, our notes here say that that this completion is not necessarily an end. It is an end of itself in the sense that it is that which has life, gives life, and causes life. Not necessarily the end as in no more progress, but rather a fulfillment of a certain level, and by its own nature, it only grows and seeks to multiply itself. And so let us not confuse an end with what people relate to death and the end of days and stuff like that. That is not a part of eternal growth. So now, and law. So now, we have, now that we've explained somehow, it's kind of okay, the whole Sheba and seven, we must add to this and to that. Shiva also may and can and very well signifies and represents the act of adding to oneself. So to Shiva oneself, to seven oneself, to multiply and grow, which is eternal. So seven oneself, the more we seven oneself, the more we add to our alignment in this lawful governance, you know, via the spirit, and our flexibility in allowing ourselves to be shaped and formed to his image and likeness. This allows for extrasensory perceptions, we could say. The more we add to this, the more dots we connect, the more we see, like the heavens unrolling like a scroll. We'll get into the scripture and it'll make a lot more sense, but just gotta review some of this material. So now we have the heavens open, some call it dimensions, degrees, and more is revealed, and we are able to see that much more, you know. Although some things may not be seen, the more we are given, the more we attain, the more we can see without seeing, but nonetheless seeing. So now, okay, now this growth becomes a relationship with the divine, and the closer we become, the more we are known of it and know it. And so let us just go on forward. So now actually let us go to the book of Genesis, chapter 28, verse 10. So it reads, "And Jacob went out from Beersheba and went towards Haran, and he lighted upon a certain place." So okay, continue. "And tarried there all night." So there is light within darkness, because the sun was set. This gives us, I guess, kind of like the idea of the west, because the sun sets in the west. So in darkness, Jacob lighted. Now, continuing, "And he took up the stones of that place and put them for his pillows." Now this is we give thanks to the Most High. This is just coming to us, but the first river, if we go, we actually give abundant thanks, because we had no idea that this was let us just go into it. Okay, so these stones, we're gonna say that there's three stones, and there's a particular reason why we're gonna just guess that there are three stones, you know. Okay, maybe Genesis chapter 2. I've never looked this up. Okay, so Genesis chapter 2, verse 10. "And a river went out of Eden to water the garden, and from thence it was parted and became into four heads. The name of the first is Pison, that is, which compasseth the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold, and the gold of that land is good. There is bdellium and the onyx stone." Okay, so that is actually, Havilah is actually referencing the earth, the material, and there are stones. There are three stones. We're pretty sure that those are the stones which Jacob rested upon, that used as pillars. This is so new to us that we are not sure that we'll be able to explain why, but you know, I fully, it'll come to me. So now continuing, so these stones are used as pillows, because there's no rest, you see? There's no rest in the head, in the ras, and we'll get to that. And continuing, "And lay down in that place to sleep." So sleep. We get the sense that the reason Ya'ikob must first needs go to sleep in order to receive this sight, this vision, this dream, is because, kind of like in on the forward, Moses is the only one that comes face to face, and Moses is drawn out of water. It's kind of like if it's the higher mind, and so one can only, so, you know, we're not even just going to say that he was asleep, but maybe in the sense that the higher mind is the only one that could get to that state. So in a kind of like in a way to explain this a little better, some of the things that we as Rastafari bear witness to can be seen but not really. So in a sense, one can only see them in a type sleep. You can only see them in your ras, in the rest state. We don't know if that even sounded all that reasonable, but nonetheless, we're gonna go forward. I mean, this is just as new for us as it is for those whom it is new to. Now, and he dreamed, and behold. Now, actually, dreamed in itself is also fatness. It's fatness in the sense that when one has consumed a lot, you get kind of drowsy and you could take a nap or something like that. So Jacob has received a lot, and thus he is receiving much. So he dreams. We receive much sight and vision. Those who feed a lot upon the word of Jah, you know, we feed the word of God Almighty, and we become fat, and thus we are able to dream those dreams, you know. And behold, a ladder set up on the earth, on Havilah, on those stones, you know, on those three stones, we're going to say. And the top of it reached to heaven. Now, actually, heaven, it's Zion. It's Sion. Sion is a resting place. We've said this before. In Spanish, we have the word... Okay, one second. Okay, in Spanish, we have the word sillón. It means couch. It means a couch is kind of like a couch. A couchin. And... watch, or give me one second. So we have Sion, which is a couch. Couch. A resting place. What is Zion or Sion? Kush. A cushion. The resting place. Which leads us to, we actually give abundant thanks because we didn't think of none of this. So now this will actually, I guess, support the fact that we introduced Havilah as the earth. And we'll get into the visuals, hopefully, hopefully, soon, because seems like we're a few minutes into the recording. So now let us go forward to Genesis chapter 2. And we left off. Okay, let us begin from verse 13. So, and the name of the second river is the Gihon, is Gihon. The same is it that compasseth the whole land of Ethiopia. The high place, the Ras, the highlands, upper Ethiopia, which is, well, actually upper Egypt, which is the highlands, the roof of Africa. And the reason we say this is because, you know, speaking Kabbalistically, it is accepted that the river that compasses the whole land of Ethiopia is actually the liquid that sustains the brain afloat. So we'll leave that at that and we'll continue. So now, let us actually read verse 12 again. Genesis chapter 28, verse 12. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. So now we have Havilah, and which is what we accepted to be those stones that placed the earth, the material where Jacob puts three stones, the onyx, the bdellium, and gold. That is good, but gold must be tried by fire, right? And so we have that triune stone set up for pillows because there is no rest for the Ras. And you know, after probably he lighted in a dark place, light shining in darkness, feasting on the word, he becomes fat and sleepy, and thus he dreams, and behold a ladder set up on the earth on Havilah, and the top of it, the Sima, the Ras, the head, the summit, reached to heaven, you know, to Cush, to the resting place, to Sion, to Zion, to Cush. Now, and it reads, and behold, the angels of God ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, well, what is the throne of the Almighty? It is Zion. It is Zion. It is heaven. And, you know, His Majesty is that fulfillment, that Sheba, that completion, as far as what we are presenting. His throne, that ladder reaches up to Ethiopia, up to Cush, up to the resting place, the couch, the cushion, and that is where the throne is set up, the throne of David, and one did sit upon that throne, and it is His Imperial Majesty, the mighty Trinity, Haile Selassie I, elect of God, conquering lion of the tribe of Judah, King of Kings of Ethiopia. So now, going forward, and behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, thy father, and the God of Isaac. The land whereon thou liest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed. So the land where Jacob liest. So he's lying down. We could even say, you know, kind of a type death, a type Sheol, or hell type, you know, because he's lying down, asleep, you know, unconscious. So going forward, and thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth, and thou shalt spread abroad to the west, and to the east, and to the north, and to the south, and in thee, and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. And behold, I am with thee, and will keep thee in all places whither thou goest, and will bring thee again into this land, for I will not leave thee until I have done that which I have spoken to thee. And Jacob awoke. You know, we arise, we awake, we become awake out of his sleep, out of our slumber, out of our subconsciousness, out of this zombie state. And so continuing, and he said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I knew it not. And he was afraid and said, how dreadful is this place. Now this fear is not the fear that this world wants you to receive. This fear is the reverence, the Ras. He has seen the ladder arise from, you know, the ladder set up on earth, and all the way to the Ras, to the head, to the Rosh, to the beginning. And actually lost track. So it says, this place, okay, and he was afraid and said, how dreadful is this place? So the reverence, the Ras Eferi, you know, this, when he says dreadful, he's talking about the dreadlocks, right? But he's talking about dreading Jah, of reverencing Jah. Not the fear of, not the worldly fears, the reverence, the respect, the conformity to law and universal governance. And so to Sheba, to an oath. Now he's in an oathful situation. Now he's respecting, you know, and aligning himself to good. And so, continuing, it says, "This is none other but the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven." So we're going to pause right there. And actually, this is very, very kind of like, this is intense. So now, this is the house of God. We dare to say that he's speaking of himself, even if he's not all that well aware that it is himself that is Jacob is speaking about himself because he was asleep. So he's not talking about an actual state. He's realizing that he himself is the house of God, and so that's why he's fearing this place, and now he's reverencing the fact that I am the house of God, you know, how dreadful, and I didn't even know it. And so he's, you know, the light is shining in darkness, and all this, and all this is being revealed to Ya'ikob, and so, and to us, as a matter of fact. But continuing, and we didn't want to read more, but it actually says, "And Jacob rose up early," so he a resurrection, he's brought back, you know. So that's kind of like explaining the angels descending and ascending. Not necessarily fallen angels, so we don't accept that to be relative to this particular situation, but rather that see, he fell in the sense that, you know, he set up some stones for pillows and he went to sleep, but then he awakes. So first he awakes. Like when the Miyadon oftentimes says that some are awake but they're still in bed. So after that awakening, then Jacob Ya'ikob rose. So now he's resurrected, he's brought up from Sheol, from the subconsciousness type, and rose up early in the morning, and he took the stone that he had put for his pillow and set it up took the stones that he had set for his pillows and set it up for a pillar and poured oil upon the top of it. Now, we didn't really think to go this far into the reading, but we're going to say that he erected a monument. We're even going to say that this might very well be that reference point. He erected a pillar. Well, we know that the Gospels, Mateos, Marcos, Lucas, and Johannes are pillars. So this is one of the pillars, and he anoints the pillar and sets it up. When it says set up, it is erecting and establishing, confirming, and you know, like just just erecting and we actually forgot what we were going to say, but nonetheless, going forward, so now we can actually explain this. Let's see, okay, 28 minutes. So now, let us try to explain all this. So, we have Jacob lying down. Now, he goes to sleep, and behold, a ladder. But first, let us actually explain Sheba. So we were talking about the six possible manifestations of motion, equal distance to each other within, from the point of origin, from the reference point. As we said, well, even actually verse 14 of chapter 28 of the book of Genesis reads, "And thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth, and thou shalt spread abroad to the west, and to the east, and to the north, and to the south." So that is actually the same as we are intending to. So we have up, down. North, east, and west. So all directions of the divine will manifesting in motion equal distance to the point of origin will be given to Jacob as an inheritance. Okay, so it says, one second, we're learning along with the viewers, so. So, west spread abroad to the west and east and north and south. Okay, so we're actually missing up and down. But nonetheless, this is the 6-day work that we were talking about. So if we are able to connect these dots, the 6 days of labor, then then the 7th day is an automatic. We actually did that kind of wrong. It would have to be something more like, well, we could do this. We'll do this. So this would be kind of like a 6 days of work. And whatever geometrical patterns the spirit decides to impose upon its ultimate will, thus making or imposing upon his motion manifestations, is kind of like spiritual personality. There's many different shapes that could be, I guess, like made manifest from these 6 points, these 6 days of work. But whatever the shapes are, it is in fact the way in which the divinity expresses its personality. And once all the possible manifestations of motion are exhausted, from at least pertaining to equal distance within themselves from the point of origin, then the 7th day is an automatic connecting of dots, and it is a manifestation to the plane of materiality or whatever different dimension or level it is in. It is an automatic connection. If we could kind of like receive that. And now there's a ladder. So Jacob is down here. He's upon Havila. He's laying upon 3 stones in a Trinity type stand. And now behold a vision. And now we'll start from up here. And so then the ladder begins taking shape. But before we go into the ladder, it is necessary to understand the doubling of, or to seven oneself. You see, this ladder can, we've been explaining 6 points and 7 being the fulfillment, but like we said, that's not the end. That's only the beginning and the next step. And so there must be multiplication in order to fulfill this ladder. There is a progression that needs to take place. So yes, these 6 points have exhausted the possible manifestations of movement in equal distance to themselves within a point of origin, a nature, a beginning. But in order to fill this the ladder that Jacob has that the Almighty has revealed to Jacob in this dream, we must take that oath, and the oath requires us to Shiva oneself, to fulfill oneself, and to multiply blessing upon blessing. And so, just to give an example, we're gonna go forward to New Testament, and this is the second epistle. The second epistle general of Petros. And so chapter 1, we're going to begin from verse 2. Okay, it reads, grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus, our Getachin, our Lord, according our Master, according as His divine power hath given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness, through the knowledge of Him that hath called us to glory and virtue. This is, okay, let's just go forward. Whereby are given to us exceeding great precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature. This is actually great. So going forward, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. So this is the whole stepping out of the fake self into the darkness, but then this prime mover, the spirit of truth, hovering above the waters, and so on and so forth, light shining in the darkness, and so now just going forward, and beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus the Christ. Jesus Christ. So we must bear fruit, but in order to bear fruit, we must be able to seven oneself and to thus multiply to all of these virtues. And well, like we read, there's seven different things that we must add to our already blessed state, having received all things in the knowledge of God, our Father Haile Selassie first, and His Son Jesus Christos. So now adding seven to that leads us to, okay, so let's see if we get this right. Okay, just give us a few seconds here. We kind of forgot how this even went, but then we get inevitably, once we multiply or Shiva oneself and fall into or agree with the oath. Okay, that's pretty, that didn't come out all that great, but then we pretty much get the idea, right? This is we tried. So okay, this is what happened. This didn't align. And so, just to kind of give ones, let's do this. If ones want to see the ladder in this formation, ones could. There's so many different ways to actually go about this, but yeah, and this kind of gives us, well, we'll conclude with how this is the gate of heaven, the Stargate. This is the key, if ones are familiar with Ethiopian cross making, This is exactly the same thing. I mean, if that's, I mean, the reason that they all differ is because the divine will wishes to maintain a lot of things kind of hidden, so that its will inevitably be made manifest. And so that's where we get all these different, you know, geometric figures and stuff like that. I mean, you know, the divine will has a way of forming us to his image and likeness. And so crosses could be created in many different ways. It depends on what the Almighty has in store for us and our willingness to be flexible and allow ourselves to be molded and shaped into a beautiful cross, you know, a beautiful self-sacrifice that we may serve him, and inevitably by, as a result of, upon taking on that task, then serve our fellow brothers and sisters within the human community. And, you know, everything is just, well, we'll conclude there. And so we give thanks to all that take the time to watch these reasonings, presentations. We give thanks and praise to the Most High God, Jah, you know, Ali Selassie first, and then through Yeshua HaMashiach. And we give thanks to, like, everyone that participates, and to all the family within the line of the Tribe of Judah Society, especially to Wendem Yadon Rasiadinos Teferi, who have given us so much. We are indebted eternally. Our brother taught us Christ Jesus, you know, and that is unrepayable. So we give abundant thanks. And to everyone within, there are too many to name, but everyone within the society, you know, Shalom. Oh, and to all the viewers also, that regardless if you happen to be Rastafari or not, you know, we appreciate the fact that you support this channel, Rastafari Fellowship, just by even checking out some of the videos and stuff like that. So support the line of Judah Society as well, and support all the members as well. So we give thanks. Shalom Rastafari.